What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of Yala, your thrice weekly podcast where we talk about the hottest news with a touch of what, Terrence?
Good old humor.
Good old humor, man.
Yeah.
It's a rainy Thursday.
Yeah. And very timely to describe, like, what's going on in Singapore Parliament.
It's in the mood, the mood.
The mood, yeah.
The grayness of the mood.
Correct.
Some would argue that it's not the gray, it's almost like it's like a disco, you know, with blinking lights all over the place.
You're saying Parliament's like a disco?
Yeah.
Oh, why, Why the analogy? Why the sudden...
Because gray sounds like a very... Like, I think there's a lot of sadness with what's going on with Parliament. Mm. But it feels like on the surface, right? It's like, it's really like a club where it feels like fucking everything pumping or exciting, you know. But deep down, right, there's a lot of sadness.
Yes, yes.
That was a club to me. La.
I see. Yeah. Sadness in the club.
Very deep sadness, yeah.
It's like a song or a poem or something.
So on the surface, everyone's like having a good time. But the moment the lights come on, it's just sadness.
Yeah. The 3 a.m. when the party, and they have to shut the party down.
And then you take the taxi home alone.
Yeah, who are you going home with tonight?
Sadness.
But our second time in Parliament.
Mm.
Another dispatch from Parliament, right? But I talk about the grayness and the sadness because, I think the first time there was a lot of excitement and all that about what's going to be debated, right? This time I walked away with a much more gray feeling about everything. Mm.
Same. I think, walking away, that was the sentiment. I mean...
But you felt sad the first one already, right? The first one, you already said. Every time you go Parliament, you're sad.
Just sad. I mean, it was nice that we saw some Yalabat fans there.
Yes.
Right? To all those who came and said hello, thank you so much. It's good to know that we're getting people more interested in Parliament, one person at a time.
Yeah, one person, two persons, or three maybe at a time.
Three, at least three. Mm. But overall, it was still an experience. Yeah. We went there at a good time. Like everything in the news today that we're going to be talking about that's taking the headlines, we were there to witness it in first person.
And we went prepared. I went in with like at least 10, 20 cent coins.
Oh yeah, yeah, correct. I have a whole pouch.
And shit happened again. Again, we used the lockers, locked our stuff. We thought we were good. And then what happened?
Then I realized that I needed my IC to change pass.
Yeah.
Then I was like, oh shit, Terrence, you got... Because my 20 cent coins were in the locker.
Genius. That's the genius. The genius.
So these are the second level people.
So
Terrence whipped out 3 20-cent coins, went in, went back, got my IC, and we were in.
But I really went full Spartan. I didn't even like wear a belt because I didn't want it to trigger off the metal detector and all that.
So
I had like, I just walked into Parliament just with my IC and 20 cent coins.
And an open mind.
Waiting to be inspired.
And an open heart also.
Why? Oh, because of all the love going on in there.
No, just open heart to, it all works together, your heart and your mind. Mm.
But I do have to say, like this time, when you talk about going in with open heart and all, it felt maybe a bit less oppressive than the first time we went.
Mm.
I mean, maybe because there were a lot more people, right? I think the gallery had a lot more people than the last time.
Mm.
This time, we did see some Yalabat listeners and all that. But in general, it just felt like a lot of people were watching the event, whether it's over live stream or in the gallery. And it didn't feel like such a strange thing to be there at Parliament compared to the last time. How do you feel for you?
I mean, similar. Because I think the last time we went was during the whole Ridout scandal, where it was still debatable whether there was anything wrong. Mm. In this case, it was clear that some shit is going down. It has gone down.
Yeah.
So,
and the people who were involved in that shit were not present.
We're not there.
They've either been taken out of Parliament or they've stepped down already.
So lots to cover. We're going to be focusing on a couple of topics, but probably we will cover the overall thing. But before we start that, Terrence, what is it you would like to say to our listeners?
I would like to say we exist on Spotify, on YouTube, but also on a lot of other social media platforms, like Instagram and TikTok.
Mm.
And in fact, Instagram is where we were updating some live, not say updating
stories,
but we were just doing some stories of ourselves outside Parliament, taking photos with Yalabat listeners and you know. So there's actually a lot of things that we update on Instagram that you wouldn't see on other platforms like Reddit and all as well. So yeah, do follow us on our social media platforms too.
Cool, man. Okay, so shall we dive into it?
Yeah.
I mean, if you have browsed the internet, be it the news sites, YouTube and all, you would have seen some things that came out of Parliament. But the first thing that we're going to be talking about is the thing about PM Lee's ministerial statement and the subsequent clarifications, mainly by leader of the opposition, Pritam Singh. Because generally, the whole process of Parliament, overall, there was the, it started off, then there was the swearing in of the new Speaker of Parliament. Then there was the NMPs. And then there was Indrani, who gave a statement on Tan Chuan Jin's hot mic issue. Then the PM gave his ministerial statement covering all the recent scandals. Some admissions on his own part. He did a little spiel in Mandarin during which I took a bathroom break. So did he say anything different, Terrence?
He did. It was very very different from everything else.
Very different. Fuck, so I missed out.
Not for you to understand.
I missed out so much for being inclusive. Then after that, there was a bunch of questions from leader of the opposition, Pritam Singh, and a few other MPs. And back and forth a lot. And then it went down to parliamentary questions. So the thing we're going to be focusing on now is that ministerial statement from PM Lee. Where he generally started off, by talking about the respective things, briefly about Ridout, and then the Iswaran, and then the recent scandal. I mean, overall, like, for Iswaran, the main things that stood out was clarifying what happened. He went through some dates and the fact that it's still being investigated now. And then it was about the scandal and how, he knew it from way back. And he even admitted that he should have acted sooner.
The Tan Chuan Jin issues.
Tan Chuan Jin and Chen Li Hui. But then he went on to say stuff about what is being taken and how, we are, it's more about how we deal with this unfortunate circumstances. So, I mean, anything else that stood out for you from that statement?
I think when we said ministerial statement by Lee Hsien Loong, it involved him talking about this in a broader context, right?
Yeah, correct.
Then after that, he had Chan Chun Sing come on to give the detailed timelines and stuff like that. Although more details about the, especially the Iswaran issue and CPIB and all.
Yeah.
So Chan Chun Sing would basically, if you think about it, I think Lee Hsien Loong was about the spirit of everything. And Chan Chun Sing was the letter, you know, letter the details, the technical details and all.
So, and I mean, like, I wasn't sure why Chan Chun Sing was doing that. But he, like, what I saw was that he is, he oversees the public service or some aspect of that. Like, there's a reason, like, because he's education, Minister of Education. But he also holds another appointment. But it wasn't clear why he was the person talking, like.
I mean, if he oversees the public service division and all, I think there were questions about, a lot of parliamentary questions were about, you know, whether civil servants have to declare, you know, how, what is the process of them declaring gifts or whistleblowing and things like that, and how that, you know, leads onto into members of parliament as well, our ministers. So that's where I think, when you're calling the integrity of the civil service in question and all,
correct.
That's where Chan Chun Sing has to stand
up. He's a minister in charge of the public service.
Correct.
Yeah, minister in charge of the public service.
Yeah, so nothing out of the ordinary for him to be doing that. It's not like, it's not like, oh, he's my favorite. He's my favorite minister. That's why he's speaking up for me, you know.
So if I could just go over certain things that PM Lee said, I mean, about the CPIP, CPIB investigation into Iswaran, he went through the timelines and then he mentioned that Iswaran has been interdicted with a reduced pay of 8,500 per month. I think that was the first time it was disclosed this whole little kerfuffle. And that he used the civil service practice as a reference point because such incidents involving ministers are rare. Then he talked about how it's still ongoing and he's unable to provide more details on the case.
Mm.
Then the resignation of former and speaker and former MP Tan Chuan Jin.
Mm.
Again, he went through the facts of the dates. He knew back in November 2020, he spoke to them, counseled them.
Mm.
Most recently in February 2023, he spoke to them again. Mr. Tan admitted he was wrong, offered to resign. He accepted. And PM Lee told him that you need to take care of your wards first.
Mm.
Then he talked about why it took so long. And one big thing was about the sensitivity to protect the families involved and the partners involved, because these sort of issues need to be taken with consideration as well. It's not just, okay, if it happens, out in the public, you know.
Mm.
Then he talked about how it's different from the case with Michael Palmer. He gave the analogy that, okay, fundamentally, is it wrong for a Speaker of Parliament to be married to an MP?
Mm, mm.
And in his mind, he said no. Mm. So it's not about the relationship per se or the perceived partiality. It's just that, yeah, like, it was problematic because they both had their own relationships.
Mm.
Then conclusion, okay, so assurance that they will deal with everything properly and transparently.
Mm.
And talked about how the systems that are in place are still systems of human beings after all.
Yeah.
And no matter how comprehensive they are, things will still go wrong.
Mm.
And then he talked about some corruption cases involving ministers, all of which were dealt with transparently and, in his words, applied the full force of the law.
Mm-hmm.
Then he said some stuff in Chinese, which was entirely different. And then, yeah, that's how he ended.
Yeah, yeah.
So then Pritam came up.
Mm.
And he, I think what has been clarified before also in Parliament is that when a minister gives a statement, the things that other MPs should ask is clarifications. Pritam came up and the first thing he said, he went into quite a long spiel about a number of issues. One of which was the, for the timeline for Iswaran and some questions there, which we will get into. Then he talked about the sensitivity of how the issue, a private issue for, say, Tan Chuan Jin was dealt with a lot of time and empathy, while the personal issue that Raisa Khan was facing or that had disclosed was dealt with a lot quicker.
Yeah.
And then after that was Trace Together. So then, I mean, we were there, we were watching it.
Mm.
It was quite a long spiel. And after that, the speaker himself had to come in and say, okay, you know, like, just to clarify, it shouldn't be a speech. Right. I'll stop there. Like, well, at that point in time, what was going through your mind?
Timely intervention. But yeah. At which point of time?
Like, after Pritam gave his spiel.
After Pritam gave his spiel.
Where he brought up the other issues.
I think, yeah, he came out swinging.
Yeah.
He didn't hold anything back and... I think shout out to the new Speaker of Parliament, Siak Kim Ping. First day on the job, and honestly, like, I think it was probably like, I think he lost the plot on the whole like clarification process already. Like, everyone had their own agendas that they wanted to put out there, and all he could do was just try his best to give everyone time to talk, but after a while, it just sort of veered off course already.
So that means not so much he lost the plot, like, he still had the plot.
He had a plot, but it was very hard to keep everyone on track.
It was damn hard.
And I'm not mocking him in any way. I'm saying that it was really tough because you could tell everyone was just itching to get their piece in, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it got pretty fiery at times. And being there, I think you could really feel the points where even Lee Hsien Loong was raising his voice, invoking God and everything, you know? Or even Leong Mun Wai, Speaker, sir, you know, like, taking advantage of the fact this is the guy's first day on the job, right? And, like, addressing him very, very aggressively as well.
Yeah.
So that stood out to me a lot.
Yeah, I mean, for me, like, when Pritam went down that whole spiel, because these are clarifications, and there was none of those questions in the standing order that was issued the day before Parliament, which means these are all questions in response to the statement.
Mm-hmm.
So when the moment he said that, because he dug up the timelines of Trace Together about how the PAP, and I mean, I'm paraphrasing, but selectively discloses information when it's convenient for them.
Mm,
and they have all the liberty to take their time to disclose stuff while for the opposition members, and he even said in an alternate dimension, if an opposition member were to take a while to disclose things, they would be slapped with like a pofma or something. Like. So he dug up trees together. And then after that, I think Indrani came up at some point to kind of say again that, if I remember the sequence, after the speaker admonished Pritam for taking them long, Pritam came up and said, oh, I'm actually not taking very long. I'm not taking any longer than PM took at the last parliament when he was responding to some questions. So I'm well within my boundaries.
Yeah.
Then Indrani came up and said, I was there at the same parliament. And I remember that PM Lee was responding to a clarification. He wasn't making a clarification.
Yeah.
So then it was back and forth. Then it felt like, oh shit, is this what's going to, parliament's going to be like? Mm. Because after that, PM Lee came to respond. And then Vivian Balakrishnan stepped up to talk about Trace Together. And then Shanmugam stepped up to talk about Raisa Khan.
Yeah, yeah.
And for the next, what, hour? It was basically the four of them, la, just having a joust. La.
Yeah. So it was, got off topic, la, basically.
Yeah.
We were dragged into stuff of yesteryear, the Trace Together thing.
Yeah.
The Raisa Khan scandal. And that was a very dark turn as well. When it started to be this debate about who was the one who insisted on using the word rape to describe the issue, you know, when and then, literally, Shanmugam was reading the transcripts of the Committee of Privileges and all that, like, right?
Yeah.
So it was like, wow, it got quite painful to sit through at that point in time. Like.
The context is like when Pritam was talking about what PM Lee said about having to handle issues with sensitivity, he did say that, you know, like, we speak of sensitivity in this case when, you know, we need to think about families and spouses. But back during the Raisa Khan saga, when it was made known that Raisa Khan was a victim of rape, the PAP and the mainstream media spared no shortage in, like giving him time. And he even said, and I remember the PM standing up here and giving me a sermon on Confucian values.
Confucian ethics, right?
Ethics and all that. And then like Shanmugam came out of nowhere and literally some things he responded and I'll quote, like, I'm sure he doesn't mean it, but Mr. Singh's statements are misleading. But it was the Committee of Privileges was very sensitive about not describing what happened to Ms. Khan, but it was Mr. Singh who insisted the word rape ought to be mentioned. And then it became like, yeah, like a personal thing, and he just came up to clarify that and then he sat down. So yeah, and then just hearing that word being uttered over and over again also felt a bit weird. Because it started becoming almost like this, like, what is the debate about? Because then Vivian Balakrishnan came up and clarified in his own very theatrical way that he objects to the characterization by Pritam. And I was sitting there, and that's when the grayness started setting in. Was it the same for you?
Yeah. I think it was a... It seemed quite clear at that point that we were not going to get super good answers on, or clear answers on, a lot of the clarifications that have been put up.
Yeah.
Like, did we learn anything new in the timeline of Tan Chuan Jin stepping down at all? I think there are very pointed questions about what were the steps taken in counseling him in 2020. What, you know, when he resigned in February 2023, earlier this year, what were the steps taken to make sure that his ward was taken care of, right? Why would it take like 5 months or whatever it took, you know? So all these things were not answered or brushed past. And the fact that we spent so much more time talking about things that have been debated before, kind of derailed the discussion. And I think you'll read out there, whether in the news articles or what, that a lot of people are saying that, we didn't get any new answers on these topics, right? So, it is. That's why, I also did feel like, politics.
Because
where we are at.
Like, just to focus on the questions by Pritam Singh, the thing about the timeline, he asked the PM, could the Prime Minister detail for us what exact steps were taken between February and July 2023 to arrange for the care of Marine Parade residents? And went on to say if that's the crux and why was he not asked to step down as speaker and remain a Marine Parade MP? And the response from PM Lee was, Marine Parade was a consideration, but all things considered, I should have moved earlier. But the important thing is we move and we brought it out and we are open about it.
Yeah.
And it was those sort of answers that kept happening. And then it reached a point where it felt like, what the hell is going on? And It felt like, okay, there's merit to debate these things, but it just felt after an hour that it had a very, I don't know, I found it difficult to watch, man. I was sitting in my seat, I'm like, oh my God, what? I don't know whether it was just like, I cannot imagine being in the hot seat like that, or partly like, why are we debating all this when there are so many other issues to get through?
Yeah.
Right. But I mean, the fact that those questions were not answered also, also causes problems.
Yeah, it's very true. I think the Tan Chuan Jin issues, a lot of it is, you can say that we've already gone past those issues because he stepped down and all that, right? But I think a lot of the questions were about the procedure, like how was he allowed to, stay as the speaker in spite of the knowledge that this was happening? How was he allowed to go on more trips, on official trips with Ching Li Hui, knowing that there was they had a clandestine relationship going on. And there, I think it was only one since 2020. But that was since 2020, right? Since 2020 when they found out. So what about the years prior and everything, right? There are all these questions of procedure that I think...
The standing select committee also?
Yeah, they were put together on a
house committee.
Yeah, a house committee together, even with the knowledge that they had a kind of relationship going on. Or they had a relationship going on. I did feel like there was this... I don't know why, but it seems like there's this real reluctance to answer about what happened to Tan Chuan Jin and all that, right?
Mm.
The procedural process of like, how was he counseled and all these things. Because I think those can be put down in fact, right? Mm. Whether you met him face to face or over email or phone call, how many times did you talk, what was the ultimatum given to him, and was he given any kind of ultimatum or anything, right?
Mm.
In 2020 and all these things. So yeah, we didn't get anything new other than the fact that Lee Hsien Loong knew about it in November 2020 already.
Why does that matter to you, Terence? Why you want to know what PM Lee messaged Tan Chuan Jin and talk to him face to face?
Again, the procedural kind of things. When you find that someone has done something wrong or in your parliament and all that, for you as a leader of the party and talking about ministerial codes of conduct and stuff like that, right?
Mm.
People want to know how you deal with these issues. Same thing with Iswaran, right? I think I think a lot of people are drilling down the timeline of who knows what, when, and when it was released, because they want to know like at what point, like when the person in power knows of something going on, and when do they decide that it's the right time to communicate it to public or to take action on it,
Or use words like assisting in investigations versus being arrested.
Yeah. Correct. Exactly. So You can't keep saying that, we deal with things very decisively and all that, but then, at the same time, you're like, I regret that I didn't, I should have done it sooner and all that,
Yeah.
It's incongruent of each other, these two opinions. And that's what I'm feeling the sense of right now. Like, I think Lee Hsien Loong is harping on how, we did the right thing, we did the important thing, we moved as fast as we could, but the timeline doesn't bear it out, 3 years, since you found out about the relationship. 5-6 months to give him, you give him 5-6 months of time to like slowly go and settle his personal affairs because of taking care of caring for the family. But what about caring about Singaporeans who would get upset about things like that?
Also the example that he gave that when Tharman resigned as MP, as minister to run for president.
Yeah.
Fairly fast.
Mm.
Halima also.
Yeah.
I think previously Michael Palmer also.
Yeah.
So, and the thing is because I also was thinking, on one hand, these things are all in the past. Why you want to dig up the dirt? Mm. But then, the biggest consequence for that, for me, is people will start talking.
Yeah.
Even when Pritam brought up that very conspiracy theory or alluding to some sort of theory about will there be any police investigation into who uploaded the video of Tan Chuan Jin's hot mic incident on online?
Yeah,
because it felt like the time was a bit too convenient And Indrani responded saying that if it's just increasing the volume of a video, then a lot of people would be guilty of it so that's not a crime.
Yeah.
But it puts that idea in people's heads, right?
Exactly, yeah.
If you think about it, of course, conspiracy theory only, it does feel when you look at it in totality, why did this come up 3 months later? And then all these scandals happened shortly after. And then Tan Chuan Jin needed to resign for some reason. And you look at his apology, which was by and large mainly focused on the hot mic thing. Was there a deflection of the actual like shit that was going on? Then it just puts these questions in your mind. Right. And even the thing about when PM Lee said that Iswaran right now is getting a docked pay of 8,500 a month, right? Like, okay, so when I listen to the logic, I actually agree with the fact that he needs to receive something because he has not been proven guilty yet. But given everything else and the lack of transparency and the brushing over the questions, it makes me think like, eh, should he get paid?
But actually, going back, before we jump to Iswaran thing, because I think there's a whole swimming pool by itself, right? The Tan Chuan Jin thing, do you agree with Lee Hsien Loong's insistence that there's nothing wrong with two members of parliament being married to each other?
Nope.
Why? Why do you not agree?
Because...
Why? Okay, so you're saying that there's still some conflict of interest somewhat? I think so. Why?
Because... Okay, so... I'm just like, just off the top of my head, if it's a private company, there are a lot of family-run companies, you know, husband, wife, CEO, COO, and shit like that, where you have to work together. But that's a private company, you know? You fuck up, you do fucking well, it impacts, it very rarely directly impacts people. And we all know with relationships, there's always a lot of emotions. And emotions sometimes make you do things that you wouldn't do otherwise.
Yeah. Correct, correct.
So if you're having them in the same cabinet, I cannot see that logic.
Yeah.
But for you?
Yeah, I mean, to me, it was a false equivalence. If two members of parliament were married and completely in the open and everything, and then they voted in and all these things, okay, at least it's transparent. We know everything. But in this case, when it's a secret relationship that, you know, like we talked about before, can compromise either individual and all that, right? Then it's really, it's not, there is a conflict already, right? You think about it, when in a football match, if you found out that the referee was married to one of the players on the team that he's officiating over, you're like what Lee Hsien Loong say, the player is not reporting to the referee, all right? It's not under direct line of report or anything. They don't affect each other's salary. But the referee's job, like the speaker's job, is to officiate proceedings in parliament and all that, right? So there will be this sense of there could be favoritism and all these things, right? And you don't even want to get to the point where people can even think there is an act of favoritism at all.
But, I mean, your question was whether, I agree with what PM Lee said about there being no issue if the speaker is married to an MP.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And you were saying that that's a false equivalence. But that was what PM Lee also said, that is different, right?
Yeah, it's different. So, in general, I think any kind of relationship between two members of parliament or that need to be scrutinized more carefully.
So, would you be okay if the Speaker of Parliament was married to an MP that was very out in the open?
Oh, no, I don't. That's not open. That's not okay. Because that's the analogy I'm saying. It's like a referee being married to a player that they're officiating in a World Cup match or something like that. It's not. There's some conflict of interest. Immediately, even without them, reporting to each other, I think there's a conflict of interest there already. That's the speaker is like the referee of a match, right? Between people in parliament and all that. So I don't understand why there's like no. They seem to be brushing by the fact that there is something wrong there.
Maybe he kind of needs to say that because his wife is also like very influential in the. In the running of Singapore, you know?
Yeah, I mean, there's some of the chatter that's going online, that there's a lot
He can't not say that, right? But then, it totally doesn't make sense. I can imagine, if you're a boss in a company and you're married to an employee, that one okay, right?
No, it's. I mean, no, actually, if that was completely out in the open and the company is, maybe it's a small business or family run and all that, then, I mean, that's how it is, all right? It is a family running the company and all that. But as you get bigger and you have, your board directors and code of conducts and all these things, then it needs to be, you need to start distancing yourself from each other.
So you think let's say a company like a huge MNC, if the CEO is married to one of the employees?
I think still problematic. This is problematic.
Oh, problematic for you?
Chain. I mean, then there's a direct chain of command, right?
So for me, that's not problematic for me because it is the company makes a stance on this.
Mm.
I don't think there's a clear right or wrong, but there's a company policy.
Mm.
When it comes to politicians, where you are making decisions on behalf of the people, it's very different from, for me, like a private or even a listed company making decisions on behalf of their stakeholders. And then I really feel strongly about it. I don't work there.
But the thing is that these things, questions of favoritism can arise, right?
Mm.
The moment that you are in some sort of, you're in the chain of command, so to speak, where you're married to someone below, and then the people in the middle, like they start to get like feeling nervous about how do I treat this
employee.
Right? So if you wanted, if you're doing things right, I think then you would try to address that by, you know, moving to another department or something where it's not a direct chain of command and all. But in this case with Tan Chuan Jin, you know, I see it much more as it's like a referee and a player in a match, where there's a very clear, not a reporting line, but there's a very clear effect that one party can have on the other person's prominence or, you know, ability to speak in parliament and all. So it's just,
it just feels weird.
And he insisted on it and repeated it again as if like he's trying to make emphasis that, you know, think carefully, you know, is there anything wrong? In my mind, I was like, yeah, there is something wrong.
You don't put up your hand.
In parliament, we can't even talk, right? So yeah, the whole thing just felt like, just such a weird justification. And I would rather that they just take a much stronger stance against it, you know? And not to say throw anybody under the bus, right? But just be very clear that these are not standards that we live by, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But now it seems like this gray area where like, oh, so can marry. Have affair, can do what? Oh, I can't help it. It's
so then all the people who are like fucking in parliament, they're like, okay, maybe if we get married, it'll be fine. If we get married, we can carry on, but we just need to get married now. Okay, we got PM Lee's permission on record that if we are married, it's fine.
Yeah.
If we are just like more than friends, then cannot.
So that's where I felt like we were going to deeper and deeper shades of grey. Where I was like, wait, what does he actually think of what Tan Chuan Jin did? Are you telling me that it would have been okay, but you know, because of public uproar and all that
I guess gives even more context for a question asking about what was the counseling process like.
Exactly.
Maybe he was like, guys, you're gonna get married, right?
Yeah.
And they're like, we're thinking about it. Because if you get married, it's fine.
Yeah.
But now this one cannot.
Yeah.
You divorce your partner, Chuan Jin, and then Ching Li Hui, you just, you know, commit, and then it'll be fine. You know, it'll be fine.
Yeah. So that's why I think the questions were all valid, right? And it's not just opposition poking and all that. I think people want to know why the process took as such. And they don't want to just hear that, we dealt with it. But you dealt with it like 3 years after you found out, you know?
I will say that I feel like Pritam could have made the same point about Raisa Khan without having to use the rape word so many times.
Because
that one... And like, I mean, I know part of the two cadres or something that used to work for WPA, they posted that they were disgusted. And I don't think I'm even being like super woke by saying it, but just by hearing it, if you refer to it, we all know what you're talking about. But the fact that it became like a prop in this argument, right? I'm just like, why are we going down to this level? You know, like now, if we like to bring up the Iswaran thing again, it's like when you see arguments like that or like false equivalences like that, it makes me reconsider my stance on like, should Iswaran get money? When I think logically, I don't think he should be docked fully, because if you want to respect the rule of law, he's innocent until proven guilty. But then now I look, I'm like, was it an opportunity for the PAP to really say that we do not tolerate even the allegations? And we are so intolerant about it that the moment you are suspected, you are almost
ostracized.
Yeah, not say guilty until proven innocent.
But yeah, don't want you anywhere near taxpayers' money or anything like that.
And then someone asked a question, I don't know, was it Denise Poir or something, saying, is this outside of the MP allowance?
Yeah.
So then it became known today that, it's not.
It's not, yeah. Because for him to not get his MP allowance, it requires parliament to, I think, like, file motion or something, get him suspended. So what are your thoughts about Iswaran still getting his $8,500?
Like, I would still say that I agree with the logic that until proven guilty, a docked pay sounds okay. And if you go by percentage of pay, rather than the absolute amount, I agree with the philosophy behind it.
Mm, mm.
But then everything else comes into play. But you ask me like that logic, I agree. But for you?
For me, the surprising thing is that it seems like, okay, there's no real precedent, right? Let's take what Lee Hsien Loong is saying is true. There's no precedent for this because how often do ministers, you know, encounter this situation? That means that a lot of this $8,500 essentially, like he said, was his decision to do it, right?
Yeah.
And he took guidance from what is done for civil servants, which is, I believe is 50% of the pay and all that, right? But at the end of the day, it's still him making the call on who to follow, what guidance to follow and all that. So I'm quite surprised that because I did have this discussion with some friends a couple of weeks ago where it was like, what is the strategy of Iswaran right now? Are they going to, you know, hang him out to dry? Like what you say, stamp down and say like, this is not something we can tolerate at all. This person is corrupt and everything. Or are they going to cushion the fall a little bit, you know? Okay, you screwed up, but you know, sorry, you got to go, but we'll take care of you when you go out and things like that. Hypothetically, right? Mm. That's the discussion. So when he declared that $8,500, then plus the fact he's still getting his MP allowance while not doing anything, you know, not even being allowed to be near his work and all that, it feels like the second option, let's cushion it for him a little bit, you know?
Mm.
As opposed to the very let's stamp this out. I don't want this guy anywhere near our, you know, our government buildings or taxpayers' monies and everything like that, right? So that's why I was quite surprised. I thought, when the group of people I was talking to, most of them felt that they would totally hang him out to dry.
Mm.
As in, this is not someone we want to associate with anymore.
Mm.
But when they said, now we're still paying him $8,500 salary, it felt like, let's cushion it a bit. Oh, just be fair to him a little bit, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's not, I don't think it's a binary thing. I don't think it's, okay, you either get your salary or you get zero.
Mm.
It could be for this moment that you are suspended, no pay leave. If you're found innocent, then you can be back paid.
Yeah.
There are ways to do it that are completely justifiable and still respect the rule of law and logic, right?
Exactly.
So I felt like did nobody in the, you know, in the team, the core management of the PAP and all that, think of that solution, right? That wouldn't make people sit up what? This guy earns more from sitting around waiting and being interviewed by CPIB than I do in 2 months or something like that. Right?
But as some people have indicated, poor thing, he cannot rent 26 right out.
only 3 months
only 24,500. He cannot rent the 28,000 plus.
To dip into his savings.
No, but exactly like what you said, because one thing that they did also say, that if he's found guilty, there will be consequences. Mm. On the flip side of what you suggested, what can the consequence be that everything he was being paid from the time that the accused crime happened, that gets clawed back?
Mm.
Because in some sense, it's also saying that if he's found guilty, this whole issue will be solved because it will be taken care of.
Mm.
So that's where it feels like, even in the speech, it's such a good opportunity for PAP to do exactly what they're saying.
Yeah.
That we will apply the full force of law.
Yeah.
That we will go above and beyond. That will be transparent. Then you look at this, you're like, hey, fuck, you want to be neutral? So you listen to it, you're like, yeah, if it's your discretion, then what sort of message are you sending?
Mm, mm.
Right. And it just felt like a missed opportunity.
Yeah. So a lot of people are saying that. So that's where our politicians are at, where they are so out of touch that they feel like, wow, I cut his pay until 8,005, then poor thing.
Poor thing. That's poor less thing. Than half, no, Terrence. Yeah.
But it's still double the median income in Singapore, you know.
Yeah.
So it's still, I think the optics of it just look really bad. And I just very surprised because I thought PAP, you know, talking about corruption and all these things would just absolutely distance themselves from this thing and not even allow any kind of conversation about, oh, how come we are still paying Iswaran this money?
That That's why.
But it came up. And then if did someone in the further digging, it's like, oh, he's also getting his MP allowance. And what? So he's getting $24,500 a month or thereabouts, right?
And then if you think about it, we have no idea about the details of the crime, but it seems like there was some issue of corruption, which means that And you know, the emphasis on like any gift worth more than $50, you have to declare and stuff. That was what Chan Chun Seng was saying. Yeah. So you join the dots, you're like, okay, chances are his case might be about misappropriating money.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Money is at the core of it.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you're still giving him this so nonchalantly, like, yes, you know, like, it is the right thing to do, I decided. I'm like, hello, walao. Come on, man.
And I felt like yesterday, like, I think, like, I've spent more time in parliament than Iswaran has this month. Yeah, but he's getting paid a lot more for it. A lot more for not being in parliament than we are.
And I mean, okay, like, objectively, on the grand scheme of things, it feels like a small issue.
Yeah.
Right, it feels like, you know, why are we even spending so much time on this? But it's like, it just has this feeling of that paints the same thing over everything. And remember walking out also, we said, wow, this one confirmed. Tomorrow is going to be a topic.
Yeah.
Because now anything to do with material wealth is a topic. Also because for the longest time, we've heard they are paid that much because they to prevent corruption. Yeah. Even now, fucking Shamugam's watches are being dissected. No?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. He was double wristing. Apple watch on the right hand and a very some expensive. Fancy, I don't even know how to pronounce it, but it's like, I think people are estimating
30 plus.
30 yeah, grand, right? 30 grand for his watch. Yeah.
Yeah, so it feels like, okay, like politics is an optics game. Yeah. They've been playing optics game for fucking long already.
Yeah.
Now, sorry, you play the game. And it just boggles my mind, whoever is in charge of their PR, their comms, their speeches, not realizing that the moment you talk about minister salary in any way, people are going to jump on it.
Yeah, correct.
That's so right. It just feels like at the end of the day, I mean, aside from that, if you don't care about the future of Singapore and future of politics in Singapore, there were a lot of entertaining moments also.
There were. What was it about being their life that you felt was different from what someone would have seen at home?
Because of the nature of the discussions, which sometimes were tense, sometimes were awkward, you can watch everyone's reactions.
Yeah.
You can look at the 5 new NMPs at the back just sitting there like, oh shit, what a first parliamentary session to be sworn in.
Yeah.
Then you can look at Leong Mun Wai's never-ending face of glee.
Yeah, he was like literally like clapping his hands gleefully. When I think
Indrani, Tan Chuan-jin's hot mic, right?
Yeah, Indrani was being asked about how she treated Tan Chuan-jin's hot mic issue given the fact that the speaker is supposed to be one enforcing a lot of the discipline and all, but she's the leader of the house, so does she actually have authority over him or what, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
So it was wow, like, Leong Mun Wai was just celebrating.
Then he also asked the question, right, just to clarify, speaker, leader, will I be getting an apology? Why was there no apology during the issue between me and Minister Balakrishnan?
Yeah,
And Vivian Balakrishnan is just sitting there.
Yeah.
And then you look at Leong Mun Wai, he's like, I mean, kudos to him for just pointing out certain things that need to be pointed out.
Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, it's like a marathon, right?
And yeah.
He's running the marathon. Maybe Tan Chuan Jin all... in his very running gung-ho thing, he's sprinted.
He's like the turtle lost, and the hair.
Exactly.
Tan Chuan-jin is like this hair, you know, like, wow, fucking...
running from house to house.
Yeah.
Leong Mun Wai just slowly just getting
the turtle, you know, Leong Mun Wai, the turtle, you know, once in a while get thrown off track, get rocks thrown at him and all, but he's just chugging along.
But I mean, just talking about that 8.5K thing again, what do you recall of it being like in the private sector, right? When situations like that happen?
Wow, that one. Okay, so I'm not fully sure, but the one thing I know, in the private sector, the moment you are being investigated for something, right? Don't even know whether you'll have a job waiting for you after the investigation.
You might be fired straight away, right?
You might be fired straight away. Yeah. Getting a next job is going to be fucking hard.
Yeah.
It blows my mind that it seems that if Iswaran is cleared, he would just jump back straight into the job.
Because it's like, I think the equivalent is like some guy working in a job, then he does something stupid on social media and then like gets the company a lot of hatred and all that, right? Straight away, the guy's gone the next day.
Yeah, they fire unjustifiably him the next day.
Justifiably. Gone. Nobody even asks about what's the processes involved in firing him or anything like that. They just like, we don't want to be associated with this guy already. So that's why I'm very shocked when I see like, wow, this guy is literally being arrested by the Corrupt Practices Investigation Bureau. And he's still being paid, you know, a very healthy salary to sit around at home. Okay, healthy by plebeian standards.
Plebeian.
But maybe cannot afford like nice watch and you know, rental a ride out and all. But it's still such a jarring thing when you talk about like, oh yeah, you know, we'll extend the fullest force of the law on it and everything. But then you know that, but you made that discretionary decision to still pay him $8,500 a month.
Like, yeah.
Right.
I think that's the one thing. Like, that's maybe just getting tiring to hear that they will, you know, I think even Chan Chun Sing said that it is not circumstances that define a generation. Mm. It's how people deal with those circumstances. Like.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then it feels like, okay, we hear this. We hear that you're fully transparent. We hear that you do not tolerate this. We hear this is how you've been operating. And here's a chance to really take action that echoes that sort of sentiments.
Yeah.
But they didn't.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, like, it was just like, you look at it, you're like, oh, fuck. Like, that's why, yeah, it was a grey feeling. La.
Yeah.
Like, parliament, attending parliament right now is bittersweet. La.
Correct.
It's bittersweet.
Yeah. And I think there was one, the, you know, I think one of the newer MPs, Carrie Tan, she came up with, to ask certain questions about whether, you know, people entering politics can have some kind of like assurance that their private lives won't be so scrutinized and everything. I'm paraphrasing.
Mm.
But I just thought it was the most inane questions ever. It's almost like even this, I could even sense that the speaker was like, carry on, get on with it. Because she was, oh, I think she asked, oh, speaker, if you can indulge me for my, I know this just for clarifications, but if you can indulge me time for my question, my questions. And the speaker was like, yeah, don't test it too much. You remember that?
No, I do remember that.
But there, I think there was somewhere in the middle. And I'm not alone. I think a lot of people on the internet are like, she just wasted like 5 minutes of everyone's
life. Do not have your... So why do you think it's a waste of time?
Because she was basically asking like, oh, you know, for singles, if they enter politics, then they know they're going to be scrutinized so hard, then they might not be able to find partners and get married and things like that.
I did not see that part.
Yeah, you got to go and see it. Just to like, at the depth of what was being discussed in parliament, the gravity of what was being discussed in parliament, and then she takes 5 minutes to kind of ask these questions.
And what was the response? What was the response?
The response were kind of like, I think Chan Chun Singh sort of just, I can't remember exactly, but it was just Chan Chun Singh gave her, you can go in, I mean more like, you can go in, we've talked about this before, or you can go and look it up somewhere, that kind of thing. Which I thought was, yeah, okay, yeah, please, thank you Chan Chun Singh for like just moving things on, because nobody's interested to hear
for
the
once
response.
His monotonous way of speaking was just, okay, curb the thing in the butter.
Yeah. You know, and one thing about Chan Chun Singh was that, and I mean this in a good way, maybe in a good way, he was really boring. And maybe that's what we need more of in life today. Boring politicians who just get shit done, don't sleep around, don't like, you know, argue, you know, theatrically in parliament about, oh, is it, can you really say this thing, Mr. Singh? You know, things like that. Yeah.
Mm.
So
actually, that's true.
Yeah. So in some ways, like Chan Chun Singh at points when he came out, although it was, to me, it was boring, but it was like, I mean, this is just a guy doing his job, lah. Right?
And there's no flavor, there's no spice.
Yeah,
he's just like, okay, I have to say this now, and you know, this is the statue of the 23. Yeah. No, but it's true. Like, maybe that is something to aspire to. The day there's a full gallery of the public watching parliament, it's not a good day, man.
Yeah.
Because then people are there for like
theatrics,
for the theatrics, and right now there's more and more of it.
Yeah.
The
yeah.
day that everyone speaks like Chan Chun Singh is a day we need to celebrate.
Correct. Yeah, so people don't get us wrong, right? We are saying go to parliament to see how affairs are conducted and all that, but not because we're gleeful to see the sauce and all that. And I say that because we left feeling quite sad, right?
Mm.
That, you know, a lot of questions were not answered, and it feels like us as a public were even more in the dark than ever, or we feel we're even second guessing a lot more of what has actually transpired in the whole Iswaran and Chan Chun Singh thing, even more than before. La.
Yeah.
And that's the part I feel sad about, that, you know, we did not get any more clarity on it. La. Like the Ridout Road issue, whatever it is, we could argue about, you know, the ethics or the conflict of interest and all that, la, right? And it was frustrating to watch. But at least details were being provided about a lot of things that were being asked, like, I felt more so than here, than in this situation, where it was just a lot of like derailing and deflecting of questions.
Yeah. And I mean, the sad thing is there were a lot of other things that were discussed, but it's never going to occupy the headlines. Because every article now, including ourselves, we are talking about the stuff that was more standout.
Yeah, correct.
Which is bittersweet also. Yeah. Right.
That's true.
Yeah, because like, if parliament is exciting for reasons other than the policies, that's not good, man. That's not good.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. What I saw and all is that I think there were a lot of people watching the live stream.
Mm.
Even those, so not just people who are in parliament, but also a lot of people watching live stream. So yeah, there was a lot of eyeballs lah. So I guess as a politician, that's the opportunity to be seen and heard lah, right?
Mm.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So the interesting thing also was just seeing the opposition, like Workers' Party, like sort of like each of them had individual questions. But like I think some like Sylvia Lim or what, she stood up to like, oh, you haven't answered her Ting Ru's second question or things like that, lah, right?
Yeah.
So it was almost like, oh, there's some behind the scenes there, like texting each other, oh, make sure you ask this question and all that kind of thing.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah. Quite interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, yeah, it's still worth going down just to understand the dynamics of it.
Correct.
And how it feels like, because it's not an easy job. Like to all MPs, it's not an easy job.
Yeah.
And kudos to you for being part of it. But when we watch these kind of things unfold, it really feels like, why?
Yeah. Correct. Why? Why?
I mean, Parliament's still going on today, and it probably will still go on till tomorrow.
Yeah. Right. There might be more. Yeah. From what I understand is because, this hot topics or that, that's why Parliament is running for 3 days rather than two. So there will still be a lot of opportunities for more things to come up. Yeah.
Oh, well. So it's a developing case.
That's right.
It is a developing case.
Yeah.
But yeah, shall we move on to the one Shiok things?
Want your comment.
Want your comment.
What is your one show comment?
My one show comment is the last podcast or the podcast before that, we just asked people to, partake in the poll questions that appear on Spotify after the episode, if you do listen to it. Right after that episode, there were quite a few responses. I'll just read off some. Someone asked, love the little improv skit about the assenters. I recall we did something like that, but I can't remember what it was about. I'm curious as to what the criteria of items decided.
It was that one where we said like the GIC, the chief economist of GIC or what, who was one of the assenters of Tharman. If Ng Kok Song also went to him asking to be an assenter for him?
Correct.
That's true.
And then, other people said, I'm curious as to what criteria of items get decided by the courts and what gets decided at the sole discretion of the Prime Minister. So that was something related to the topic. Someone else asked, do these responses qualify for one show comment too? And the answer is a resounding yes. So keep them coming, man. And I think we can make these comments or some of them publish to make it public. So the ones I just read out, I'm going to publish them. I have no idea what's going to happen. But it'll probably show up on the episode.
Yeah.
Cool. And what about you, man?
We get a lot more comments on our YouTube channel now. So one that came up like 4 days ago, it's always nice to hear people who are listening to us for the first time, whether they discover us through YouTube or what. But Ishnin said, very underrated, fair and honest podcast. Unlike other podcasts which ends with a specific source. Keep it up.
Specific sauce.
So then some people responded asking, sauce? You mean what do you mean?
What
you mean
sauce?
Like gossip sauce or like
SOS sauce?
Like another kind of sauce, like
sauce, a condiment. Condiment.
So it's just pretty funny to read people making insinuations like that.
Cool. Then what about the one Shiok thing, man?
My one Shiok thing, off the back of like something we had discussed prior was actually from Piers Morgan interviewing Sam Harris about the 1975 kissing on stage in Malaysia. I think it's pretty interesting because for context, Piers Morgan is a UK TV presenter who's seen as generally quite quite combative and quite in some instances right, seen as more conservative lah, right? And he's talking to Sam Harris, who is also from the US, who's known to be a writer, author, philosopher, who writes a lot about the human condition and things like that, like, and how to think about your place in humanity. So it's quite interesting that they talk about the Matt Healy LGBT kiss, the stunt in Malaysia, but the conversation veers into something into a bit more contentious issues about the role of religion in society.
And Sam Harris is quite a known thought leader as well.
Yeah, he was the guy who, remember Ben Affleck once had an argument with him about him being an Islamophobe in a video.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, that was Sam Harris. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, he also runs a very successful podcast.
Correct, yeah.
And he's written quite a bunch of books.
Yeah, but he has very strong views about the role of religion in secular life and all that. So, yeah, and they reference certain things like, remember the Richard Dawkins interview where Richard Dawkins just clammed up when talking about issues like that. So yeah, they referenced it and talked about it in this 11-minute video.
Oh, is it? It's on Piers Morgan's show, lah.
Yeah, yeah, it's on Piers Morgan's show. So
interesting.
It's and because it's related to what happened in just up north in Malaysia, it's quite interesting, lah. But yeah,
cool. My one shock thing is an article published by The Athletic, titled "David Beckham: The Interview: Miami, Messi, Manchester United, and More."
Yeah,
and it's one of those longer form articles that talks about...
You subscribe to The Athletic?
No, I don't subscribe. Oh. This was one of those free ones.
Okay, okay.
Or maybe you can read a number of free articles a week. So it talked about... he's one of the co-owners of Inter Miami.
Yeah.
Who recently signed Lionel Messi.
Yeah.
You know, arguably the best player in history. Mm. And he talked about the process of signing Messi and what it meant to him. And yeah, even the formation of Inter Miami came about back in 2014 when... Beckham himself realized that towards the end of his career that he never wanted to go into coaching or never wanted to go into managing, but he still wanted to be involved in football. And an opportunity came up when he was playing in MLS to kind of license the franchise of one of the teams. So Inter Miami only started a few years ago.
Yeah.
And it was the brainchild of him and two other co-business partners.
Mm-hmm.
And the process of bringing Messi had its seeds years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And in this article, Beckham just talks about how, he had one line, he said he never thought he would feel what he felt as a player after a moment like this, after stopping being a player. And he said it was one of the biggest things that he has ever managed to pull off, bringing Messi to Inter Miami, because... Yeah. For the good of football and for the good of changing the face of the game in the US. So I thought, hey, shit, this article gives a lot more depth to Beckham being involved in Messi going to Inter Miami.
Yeah.
So it's quite interesting. Quite interesting. And you can see the passion. And you hear some stories of players once they retire, then they just lose their money or just become aimless. For Beckham to realize that, towards the end of his career, he needed to find his next thing that's going to be for the rest of his life.
Yeah.
And now he's just fucking just doing it.
Yeah. And I think LeBron and all are also investors into Miami.
Potentially, yeah. Yeah.
So, and it's really being an ambassador for the sport and bringing it to a new, a place, a very, very big market, right?
Exactly.
Where soccer or football isn't the most popular thing.
Yeah.
So, I thought this years ago, when he first went to MLS, and that was a very big thing back then, because it was really what the hell, David Beckham still has so much to give. Why is he at MLS now, right?
Yeah.
And then he flirted and still played with AC Milan
after
and all that, right?
Yeah, correct.
So I remember back then, that was when we were studying the US and all. I remember a lot of Americans there were this is just a cash grab, He's just there because, for the money and things like that. But over the years, it has borne itself out that he's
actually
doing more
than
that.
Because
of money, money, he's got no issues with getting money or getting endorsements and things like that.
Yeah.
But setting a football club isn't exactly the fastest way to make money either, right?
Yeah, exactly. And he's literally setting up a football club, building a stadium and shit like that.
Yeah.
And the seed of it was when he was there. And what you said, the thing about David Beckham, he started off in England, then he went to Spain, then he went to the US, then he went to Italy, then he went to France.
Yeah.
Technically, a lot of the big countries he covered already.
Yeah.
And now there's one line he said, I have come in every single morning at 7:30 a.m. just to see Messi, to just know it's real.
Yeah.
Oh, it's crazy, man. Yeah. So it's a nice article.
Cool.
Yeah, man. Cool, man.
Awesome.
Awesome. Okay, cool. Thanks so much for listening, everybody. And we'll talk to y'all soon.
Cheers.